Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Aeson Black by Vera Nazarian. Narrated by Paul Woodson. Aeson Black. I remove the black armband, dutifully fold it into a perfect square of silken fabric, and place it on the nightstand near my bed. The nightstand varies depending on where I sleep that night. In a crowded fleet barracks, in the grand and solitary Crown Prince's quarters at the Imperial Palace, where every piece of ancient decor belongs in a museum, at my spacious home in Foenios Heights, filled with modern luxury, in a cramped crewman's shipboard cabin, or in somewhat more accommodating fleet officer's quarters, such as now. Sometimes the nightstand is an antique piece of furniture made of priceless lacquered wood. At other times, it's a metal shelf emerging from a ship's hull, or a makeshift stack of items rising from the floor. The ritual grounds me. Ever since I awoke from the black and drew my first newly living breath, filled with an undefined but real urge and purpose, small rituals became important. Such as tonight, here and now. Now is a grim moment, 6 years later, on board the Imperial Command Ship 2A Fleet Vessel under my command, presently fulfilling the final stages of a complicated and fateful mission to Earth and back. Early in the morning of this same day, 3 days before our scheduled arrival on Atlantis, I've had a soul-shattering conversation via interstellar with my Imperial father. As soon as it ended, I disconnected our secure video call quantum comlink across the universe. Then I called in my three aides, all waiting outside my office, Genyo Rukat, Anu Vey, and Gwen Lark. I told them that we've been ordered by my father, the Imperator, to the Imperial Palace as soon as we arrive in orbit, and that he expects to see Gwen Lark immediately, to be brought before him at court that same evening. They must have noticed some of my initial agitation, especially in those first moments when I conveyed to them the Imperial orders, which is unforgivable of me. What I did not tell them was the true gravity of this Imperial command, and what it really means. I'll never forget that call. Our exchange was precise, unemotional, coldly controlled, a typical interaction between the Imperator and his heir. And yet, something was different. A new sense of inner conviction arose inside me, even as I listened to my father's casual and terrifying words in regard to a person who has increasingly taken on significance for me. This person? I fixate on the Imperial words now, dwell on their cruel meaning, reliving our conversation.
As soon as you land, you'll bring the girl directly here.
Romhutat Kassiopei, my father and the Archeon Imperator of Atlantida, tells me during our call.
In fact, let's have her present at the court assembly as we welcome you home, so that I can have a first look at her while she's still fresh. Afterwards, she'll be escorted straight to the research facility and surrendered to the STA lab techs.
Surrendered? For how long? I ask in a neutral tone.
As a potentially valuable asset, she'll be held indefinitely. That voice. We must know how and why she has it. We must know everything.
Fortunately, her Earth refugee status puts her in undefined territory. Undefined as in questionable rights, which gives us much leeway. There might be legal concerns raised at some point, but not if we keep the whole operation quiet. This is now a matter of national security, not public scrutiny.
I see.
My tone remains steady and controlled, as I put every effort into keeping it blank, emotionless, same as the muscles of my face.
Will this be a problem for you?
The Imperial Dragon rests the full force of his perceptive gaze on me.
As long as basic ethical standards are upheld, none whatsoever, I respond at once, like an automated line of program code in a preordained subroutine.
I speak before I fully understand what is being said to me, before I allow myself
to feel. Knowing in advance that I must always employ the same perfectly bland, guarded subroutine with my father when it comes to anything pertaining to her. Allowing a precisely timed, casual pause, I ask, "What will happen to her?" The Imperator observes me. After a close scrutiny for my gut reaction, and seeing none, he appears satisfied and continues. "She will become the property of the Institute and undergo thorough study, a barrage of tests, full genome, neural activity, reproductive viability, and so on, under multiple stages of clearance, starting with the first level STA clearance on level 1. Basement level 1, or the red sector of the classified research facility underneath the Stadion, is a place I've come to know as a black site biological dissection lab, where certain human subjects disappear, never to see the light of day again. Subjects are invariably criminal convicts stripped of rights. Even so, the ethics of it always bothers me, has bothered me, since the first time I visited the secret facility more than 3 years ago, on a cursory tour given by Shiratet, the first priest of Cassiopeia.
"Do not be concerned, my imperial lord. They are murderous villains," Shiratet informed me that day, speaking firmly, and I tried to take him at his word. "But not this girl," I think now, recalling that disturbing tour. Small cells with listless or catatonic subjects held in restraints, prodded and questioned for hours by impassive techs. Rooms of others attached to machinery and receiving chemical fluids. In some cases, being vivisected. No. Far from being a criminal, she is just a harmless young woman who works for me at the Central Command Office, alongside my two regular aides, Anuve and Genio Rukat. She's done nothing wrong, except impossibly having the logos voice of my dynasty, a voice that she, a native of modern Earth, is not supposed to have. She is innocent. Not only that. She is extraordinary. Bright, talented, deserving the best opportunities and full personal freedom to live her life. And now she is being stripped of all rights and will be treated as a specimen, experimented upon, inevitably hurt. An explosive surge of emotion strikes me. Fury and fierce rebellion soaked in despair overwhelm all reason. Suddenly, there's a violent need to protect, to rush to her now, to stop the injustice, to do something, anything, to... Do what? What? I grow very still, halt my breathing, even as I battle to put down the ridiculous emotional storm with a cold force of will, restoring icy control of my veneer. But the struggle continues. My traitorous mind presents me with endless images and details of her, who and what she is. Young, intelligent, wildly creative and outspoken, a female Earth refugee whom I singled out for her potential and with whom I've interacted closely for the greater part of a year during our journey back to Atlantis. Our interactions were, still are, complicated. Furthermore, she is Gwen Lark. She is Rawabashtu.
"Very well," my father says after a small pause, and I have no way of knowing if he sees through me, recognizes my inner turmoil. "Make sure you have her ready and present at the assembly. No need to inform her of the details. She will be processed afterwards. This way it will be easier for her and for you."
"Consider it done," I respond, ignoring his last phrase. "Anything else?"
"No, this is sufficient for the moment. You may return to your duties. You have the last stages of quantum stream deceleration to worry about, and the logistics of processing millions of refugees," the Imperator says with an edge of sarcasm, still unraveling me with his gaze.
"So I'll leave you to it. Safe arrival."
I respond with polite, courtly words, and our call is concluded. My secret inner response shocks me, and is still reverberating through me in a grim echo, like the effects of a logos voice command. But I allow none of it to show, not even now, many hours later. Even though I'm completely alone in my personal officer's quarters, with no witnesses to my reaction. Of course, completely alone is only an assumption. My father has spies and surveillance equipment everywhere. Even light years away from my home planet and the Imperial Palace, I cannot discount the likely presence of nanocams, auto-dispatched to observe me alone in my cabin, to record my every breath and movement. Indeed, my father knows and suspects that Gwen Lark is important not only because of her voice, but because of what she is to me. And what exactly is she to me? Whatever it is, I must face it at last. Here, now. There's no more reprieve for me. To ground myself, I return my attention to my neatly folded black armband that's presently lying on the narrow metal shelf jutting from the cabin hull. It's right next to the chair on which I sit and the modest cot on which I'll be sleeping tonight, eventually. Such a claustrophobic small space, my officer's quarters. Not much larger than other ship cabins, with a narrow cot, small desk and chair, wall-retractable, height-adjustable bathroom facilities, and a shower stall. Yet it's sufficient for my needs. Distracted by these useless peripheral details, my mind attempts to wander, unwilling to face what must happen next. So I forcefully slam it back under control. I keep my mouth in a straight, controlled line as I focus on nothing but the square of black silk fabric and think. One thing is certain. The ramifications of the conversation with my father and my forthcoming decision are about to change the course of my life. Right now, in this moment, I freely acknowledge what I've already done in my thoughts, or am about to do. Done. Will do. Am doing? Yes, time occasionally superimposes on itself and blurs for me, ever since emerging from the black. It's been happening with diminishing frequency, as the event of my death recedes. But when it does, it's enough to briefly dissociate me from the present moment. Losing track of then and now, my mind swaps the chronology of events, a side effect of shared alien consciousness. For them, the Pegasae, all time exists simultaneously, or does not exist at all. I turn back to my immediate present. In this dire moment, even my heartbeat slows as the terror and thrill of my pending decision, with all its repercussions, combats within me. Light and dark, clarity and confusion. The bonds of duty, or the freedom of strange, unexplored emotions. I am plunged in thought, plunged in feeling. Once more it rises. Rawa Bashtu! It rages inside me, swirling uncontrollably like the forces of the accretion disk of Ae-Leiterra, which I somehow escaped, miraculously, unbelievably. But no. I did not escape so much as I was engulfed at the quantum level, given a dimensional membrane in order to halt my dissolution, and made to exist, disembodied, in some other separate place, without pain, or worry, or need, or desire. Yes, time is blurring again. As soon as I think of it, allow myself the stupid, comforting distraction. Comforting because I was gently cocooned by alien frequencies spiraling all around me in a double helix, by strings of light, held together in a fixed vibration, held in place while I resonated dissonantly, teetered on the edge of dissolution. Varkud Ae-Leiterra, then settled into a stable phase, and ultimately was forced back into cohesive form, even as my physical outer shell was being ravaged. But no, it too was somehow partially preserved. Just enough charred remains to give the human med techs something to work with, as they restored my damaged body. In short, I was forced back from chaos into an information construct. An entity, a sentience, my own unique self. Words are useless as I try to recreate the process of what was done to me by the shining alien beings whom we know as Pegasae a little over 6 years ago,
When I died on that fateful Rim mission in the year 9764, a 13-year-old Imperial Prince fulfilling his duty to his bloodline. To be honest, I don't understand or remember much of what happened when I died, plunged into black, into nothing, and then a resumption. And yet, what or where was I in the interim when I was dead? What am I? What is death? What is the black? Death is just another membrane. According to the Pegasae, it's a separator, not a thing unto itself. And it's so hard to put it into temporal words for the very reason that it is not temporal. It exists outside of space-time. Death is a transdimensional quantum phase change that affects sentience. Human physical science refers to death as loss of information. Information is what makes any given entity what it is. And without the cohesiveness of an information construct, without a stable frequency resonance, there is no being, no life, no meaningful pattern, no order. If my father only knew about these exotic thoughts I have, he would think me unfit to rule as his heir. Good thing he knows nothing about the Pegasae, or what actually transpired. As always, once the retrospection begins, I cannot stop. I analyze the black, the oblivion. I've been given the rare opportunity to understand and self-reflect upon my own death, my own loss of timeline. Therefore, I persist in trying to remember it, all of it. Sometimes there are faint glimpses and strange details emerge. In those details, I am alien. The rainbow quantum phase cocoon of the Pegasae engulfs me, and I distinctly feel the rushing stream of plural times, the universal river of data all around me that is full of others, yet is also me. Details of my life before death rush past me, my earliest youth and childhood. They coalesce so far back that they come to the moment of my first conscious memory and my birth as an infant. However, like the flow of a great river, they keep going. Almost casually, I recognize that the moment of my first official birth is also a resurrection from some other place, and that before it there were other details. Other data, other lives. There is life before birth. No, stop. Do not retreat that far back. It is not advisable. Instead, relive this life. And so, details of my current existence engulf me. One such detail, impossible, misunderstood, unrecognized by me for a long time, is the image of someone's blue eyes. I recall thinking of Ae-Leiterra right before oblivion, and yet the dissonance of that one detail, blue eyes instead of brown, confounds me. Or at least it did, until something fell into place. It happened sometime after I met Gwen Lark. I flash back to the year 9770, or Earth year 2047, according to their common modern calendar. The fleet is stationed in low Earth orbit, has been for months now, intentionally, so that our Ark ships are visible from the surface, and we've made our presence known to the global population. In the course of overseeing aspects of the qualification process, I am asked by my sole commanding officer on the Earth mission, Imperial Fleet Commander Menakteon Resoi, to make random appearances at various regional qualification centers, before choosing one RQC as my base of operation. While I'm second in command of the mission, I am also the Imperial Heir of Atlantida. We decide that for security purposes, it would be best for me not to select an obvious high-profile urban center location such as New York, Beijing, Los Angeles, New Delhi, Moscow, London, but one of secondary importance. It would make me appear less conspicuous, and at the same time would permit me to observe and conduct my business. Meanwhile, the commander himself and the other two command pilots of the fleet will establish their presence at the more high-profile sites. And so,
I tour RQCs around the globe, settling on the major power players, China, United Hindustan, and the United States, but looking at the less prominent cities and regions within those nations. On the first day of qualification, while the children of Earth take their preliminary qualification aptitude tests, and the fleet arc ships ascend from lower orbit to a more secure one, no longer visible to the naked eye from the surface because it no longer matters to our purpose, my two aides and command deck officers run population demographics analysis programs and present me with a short list of the 20 most ideal, innocuous locations, and I begin to visit the ones that appear the most promising. In just a few hours, I narrow down my preferences to 5 sites. 2 Chinese villages, a mid-sized settlement in United Hindustan on the shore of a large river, and 2 sites in the United States on the opposite coasts. I dispatch various pilots, including Astra Daimon from my own command ship, to the surface, and assign them as official ACA-sanctioned instructors on a trial basis to teach the first classes at these 5 sites that piqued my interest. Xelio Vekahat goes to a village in southern China, Erita Kwas to the river settlement in United Hindustan. Tiliar Vahad gets a small Oregon town on the west coast of the United States, while Owala Kegeri and Keruvat Ruo pair up to cover an east coast location in Pennsylvania. As the ACA Imperial Liaison, Nefir McKay tells me he will handle culture instruction, not only at the remaining Central China village, but at all 5 sites, and report back with his personal recommendation. By the second day of qualification, the first official full day when the pre-qualified candidates wake up in the morning in their new dorms, having arrived the night before, and the actual classes begin, I take a shuttle down to the planet's surface and make a quick series of stops on 2 Earth continents. I observe the RQC compounds, the crop of candidates at each, the surrounding environment. I attend the specific classes taught by my officer friends to get their final recommendations. By the end of the day, I'm leaning toward Vahad's picturesque and well-planned compound location in Willamette National Forest near Eugene, Oregon. However, one more site remains, in Pennsylvania, where the last class of the day, combat, is being taught by Kegeri and Ruo, which I expect to be a real showcase of both their stellar skills and antics, and an amusing look at their Earth students. Indeed, Care and Owala do not disappoint. I land in Pennsylvania, walk from the airfield to the specific dorm, all the while evaluating and examining this compound, and finding it sufficient but less effective for my operational needs than the Oregon site, and follow the Daimon to the designated basement floor gym. There I see a terrified class of candidates lined up in 2 rows opposite each other in the gymnasium hall. Compared to the trim and fit, highly focused teenagers I observed in China, or even their United States counterparts in Oregon, these young people are mostly in rough physical shape, with sloppy posture and poor control of their own bodies. Instead of being focused, they appear resigned. Looking at this pathetic group, I highly doubt that many of them will train well enough to qualify. Owala introduces me, in her playful hyperbole fashion, as an important visitor, almost defeating the purpose of my intended anonymity, and embarrassing me somewhat by her excessive praise. I'm presented as Command Pilot Aeson Kass, Kass being the name I've decided to use on Earth to draw attention away from my imperial rank, and Astra Daimon is mentioned to further aggravate me. Then she and Keruvat begin the combat demonstration, starting with quadrant weapons. I stand aside and watch them and the class in action. First, there are the usual warm-up exercises, during which the candidates show themselves to be even more out of shape than I suspected. Much groaning and breathless panting, and poorly executed movements. What do they even teach these Earth kids? Their education curriculum is obviously to blame, but with this particular group, it could just be the luck of the draw, or even regional variation. As my thoughts coldly analyze the potential of this underwhelming lineup, Kiruvat directs a candidate to help him carry the weapons bag from storage to the floor for the quadrant weapons demo. I watch the rest of the candidates stagger upright from their apparently uncustomary physical exertions. Stilled in pitiful postures, they wait for whatever comes next. Care empties the weapons bag, dumping its contents to the floor, nets and cords. I recall that this is a yellow quadrant dorm. Awala must really be enjoying herself. The two daimon begin the standard introductory weapons routine to demonstrate the quadrant circle of dominance, sufficiently impressing everyone present with their speed and skills. I note stunned expressions among the candidates, genuine amazement, dropped jaws, absolute rapt attention. Indeed, the simple elegance of how each quadrant weapon defeats the other and is dominated in turn never fails to astound the first-time audience, on Earth or Atlantis. Here, childhood memories of my own first combat demo come to me. I'm at the Imperial Palace sparring gym, my personal tutors preparing me early, long before Fleet Cadet School, as is suitable for the Imperial heir. When it's over, everyone claps, and I clap also, in their Earth manner of only putting palms together, as opposed to the Atlantean fleet formal mode of striking the top of a closed fist with the palm of the other hand, or even the boisterous civilian manner of hitting one's own body parts and random nearest objects and even people. Awala rubs her arms where the Viatoyos armored sleeves protected her from the volley of projectiles that Care just shot her way. "You have just learned the basic tenet of Atlantis weapons combat," she tells the class. "Yellow cord trumps green shield, trumps blue firearm, trumps red blade, which in turn trumps yellow cord. It's an eternal circular balance, a great square, somewhat like your Earth game of paper, scissors, rock." I recall that the actual name of the Earth game is Rock, Paper, Scissors, but don't bother to correct Instructor K. Gary before the class, since it would be inappropriate, not to mention trivial. Instead, I listen as Awala and Kiruvat handle the inevitable questions that follow. A frightened girl wonders how they can learn all these weapons in so little time, which gives Kiruvat the segue to discuss weaponless combat and introduce them to Erdu. Moments later, Awala turns to me and once again puts me on the spot, even though in no way do I show it. Here it's only my public face, blank and controlled. The girl is up to her usual antics. "With your permission, Command Pilot Cass, may I have the honor, Daimon?" Awala asks me, motioning with her hand, an invitation to spar. I pause, thinking, "Bashtu, Awala." Then nod. These young Gebi are in for a shock. And we proceed to fight before a room full of dumbstruck Earth boys and girls. I know this is instructional, and we have to show off a little to sell Erdu, but I do feel bad for them, watching the two of us move and react with such preternatural speed. No need to mention that Earth's lighter gravity makes our sparring workout that much easier for us. That's the big secret. It probably makes us appear as superhuman, and maybe even a little bit magical, but that's all it is. Easy gravity combined with well-honed skills and reaction times. We've lived and trained under artificial Earth gravity for some time now up on the Ark ships during the journey here. And I'm not wrong about the impression we make. When Awala and I are done, ending our demo with the floating swan, are breathing almost undisturbed, the candidates appear stunned. They've been watching us do stuff they might see in the movies or television, the Earth version of media entertainment feeds. I admit I enjoyed myself, and yes, I'm amused, but keeping it in check. Bashtu, Awala. Awala steps back and lowers her head in the formal bow. "My profound thanks, Astra Daimon." I nod to her, and straighten also, stepping out of the form. "A pleasure as always, Daimon Awala." That's when a boy asks, "Wait, what?
She's a daimon too? What's a daimon again?
I mentally groan, watching how Care and Awala will extricate themselves.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.